Ces t-shirts un peu à la Tyson, elle est sur tout court.
Et là, malgré ce qu'on dit,
tweet from Michael Benson, Bob Arum on Spence versus Crawford.
Hey, Spence doesn't want to do the fight. Aww. And why should he? He can grab money fighting guys he doesn't have a problem beating. We want to make that fight. But it takes two to tango. Spence is hiding behind Al Haymon.
Errol Spence Jr. himself took to Twitter, made a promise that everyone would get their turn. I guess this is supposed to allay the fears the fight fans have that these two welterweights will never fight. I guess Errol Spence Jr. was attempting to allay those fears and quell the growing unrest that the fight fans are having with the welterweight division, that there's just no reason for these guys not to fight in a timely fashion. They're still in their primes, they're both unbeaten fighters, they're both world champions, there's no good reason for them to have to fight anyone else next! But in all likelihood, they will. And I think that's why Errol Spence Jr. felt it necessary to release that tweet. But rest assured, everyone's going to get their turn. Yeah, but when? Because we've been hearing this for 3 years!
You know, that's why it's going to happen. Hopefully he beats Jeff Horn and gets that belt. And like I said, I want to be undisputed welterweight champion of the world. So when he does get that belt, we can make it happen in the future.
This is what I'm saying. This is what I read it on too. Terrence Crawford, wait till he get a belt.
Yeah.
He ain't did nothing in the welterweight today. When he get a belt, you want to go over there. Keith Thurman want to go over there. And now y'all want to say, oh, I ain't fought nobody. But I got a belt now, so
okay.
Sean Porter got a belt too.
So why am I
go to easy road and not Sean Porter out? Why wouldn't I?
But what did you think of Terrence showing up ringside? Do you think that helps build some buzz to make it a big fight?
No. I don't know why he doing what he was doing here. I probably wouldn't go to none of his fights, so I'm not worried about Terrence Crawford, like I said.
Spence doesn't want to do the fight. If Al Haymon made one call, we could get the contracts done in 10 minutes.
Errol Spence Jr.'s fans exhibit no enthusiasm for this fight. If you actually have the stomach to talk to one of these guys, they're going to offer up all sorts of excuses and alternatives and how Terrence Crawford should have to face a top 5 welterweight before entering into the ring with Errol Spence Jr. when Mikey Garcia didn't have to fight a top 5 welterweight, and he got the fight pretty easy. So why should a reigning champion at this weight have to jump through hoops for the same thing?
Because Errol doesn't want the fucking fight!
That is the long and the short of it. Errol Spence Jr. doesn't want the fight, and his fans don't want the fight. They exhibit more enthusiasm towards seeing Terrence Crawford fight anyone but Errol Spence Jr. Same applies to Spence. They exhibit more enthusiasm towards, Errol Spence Jr. versus Keith Thurman, as opposed to unifying titles with Terrence Crawford. These guys would rather sit there for days and weeks on end, arguing about the fight, as opposed to advocating that the fight be made. This is how they get off. This is how they try to cover Errol Spence Jr.'s tracks, citing a lack of enthusiasm from Terrence Crawford, who's been pursuing this fight for 3 years, and this is really a common sense argument. How do you expect Crawford to be jumping out of his skin to have that fight when he's been pursuing it for 3 years? And for 3 years, Errol Spence Jr. has been putting it off.
They'll say Crawford hasn't fought anybody at this weight.
Which, in hindsight, really isn't even true, though even if it were, Neither did Mikey Garcia, and you guys didn't have any aversion to Errol Spence Jr. fighting him, so why should Errol fighting Crawford bother you?
They're afraid Errol's gonna lose.
That is, once again, the long and the short of it. Without an equal demand from the fans that are on both sides of the aisle, ladies and gentlemen, this fight don't happen. This fight don't get made. And the boxing scene here in the United States continues to suffer for it. It will dwindle, as, in case you haven't noticed, boxing ain't what it used to be in America.
Let's move to the background.
The audience, it is shrinking. Oh, granted that boxing is flourishing in other parts of the world, in other markets, but here in what was supposed to be, what is supposed to be the pinnacle of the sport, at least it was in the past, that's no longer the case. And this type of stuff, this is why. Errol Spence Jr.'s handlers, and rest assured, he has them. He is a handled fighter. In spite of all his assertions that he doesn't have a promoter, he takes his cues from Al Haymon. They'll dangle this Crawford fight in front of the fight fans and use its synergy, what synergy it has left, as many people are losing hope that it'll ever happen. But better still, they'll dangle this fight in front of the fight fans and in the mean and between time, stage high-priced alternatives. Errol Spence Jr.'s last three fights have all been pay-per-views. And they've all been pay-per-views that the fight fans weren't asking for. The fight fans weren't asking for a Mikey Garcia fight, a Sean Porter fight, or a Danny Garcia fight. They weren't asking for any of that. What they were asking you for was a Crawford fight. And you keep giving them substitutes. Substitutes that cost an arm and a leg.
They want to make out like bandits.
Errol Spence Jr.'s fans are quite content taking to social media and engaging in circular arguments, tit-for-tat kind of stuff, saying, well, nobody asked Crawford for a Mean Machine fight or a Khan fight or a Brook fight. Yeah, but those are the guys he fought because of what your guy said. Because it's your guy that keeps talking about cleaning up his side of the street. It's been 3 years! Is it clean yet?
Crawford, is that a legitimate chance of happening, or do you guys feel like you're miles and miles apart?
I don't want that fight.
Yeah, you were right.
Ow! The story seems to be that Team Spence wants to fight three times in 2021, moving forward, per Errol Spence Jr.'s father, Errol Spence Sr. And, you know, maybe they pull it off. Maybe they do fight three times next year, though there's no guarantee that any one of those three times it's going to be against Terrence Crawford. They'll conjure up anyone and everyone they have to put distance between Errol and Terrence. I mean,
they have.
You know, why would we start taking Errol Spence Jr. at his word? Why would we take his word at face value now, 3 years later, after he said that he would fight Terrence Crawford so long as he got a belt? Why would we take him at his word now when he has so obviously gone back on it? I mean, if this guy plans on fighting three times, you know, maybe he has a Sean Porter rematch? Sean Porter's last fight was a WBC eliminator, that Formella fight.
Did you guys know that?
Errol Spence Jr. is the WBC champion. Coincidence? There's a lot of talk right now about Sean Porter being in a pole position to challenge Terrence Crawford for his WBO title. And when it comes to that fight, I'm not against it. I just don't think it's a requisite. I just don't think it should come before a unification match. But if Sean really wants the fight, he'll push the WBO to enforce the mandatory. The same way Alexander Usyk, the heavyweight division, is pushing the WBO to enforce the mandatory. The same way that, not that long ago, Jack Catterall was pushing the WBO to enforce the mandatory. He did agree to step aside, but better still, if Sean really wants that Terrence Crawford fight, that's all he has to do. Push the WBO to enforce the mandatory. I don't want to see countless articles and videos about the goddamn shit. I don't want to hear a bunch of sound bites, a bunch of quotes, a bunch of this and that. If you want the fight, you push the WBO to enforce the mandatory. Problem solved. This isn't the first time that a PBC fighter has ended up in a pole position to challenge Terrence Crawford for his WBO title. Did you guys forget that Danny Garcia was once the number one contender via the WBO? And he didn't push them for the fight. This is obviously before he fought Errol Spence Jr. This is obviously, was obviously, an opportunity for Danny to lock horns with Terrence Crawford in the professional ranks, and he chose to go the other way. So now that Sean finds himself in a similar position to Danny, all Sean has to do if he wants the fight is push the WBO to enforce the mandatory. Maybe Bob Arum is averse to the fight because he doesn't want to have to come out of pocket for a Sean Porter. I don't rule that out. Maybe Bob isn't crazy about the fight, but you know what? Forget about Bob. Hey, Sean, if you really want that fight, push cash for it.
Force them to give it to you.
But worse, you put them in a situation where it goes through a purse bid, and Top Rank's got to pay through the nose to ensure that Terrence Crawford stays on the ESPN side of things. I mean, at worst, that's what would happen, because I hardly think that Terrence Crawford would vacate the WBO title. Hardly think he'd vacate his belt to get out of a fight with Sean Porter. I'm sorry. Sean dropped the decision to Keith Thurman in what was a very entertaining fight. He put on a very entertaining spectacle with Errol Spence Jr., but I don't see a guy in Sean Porter that Terrence Crawford has to worry about. I don't. And I've talked about that fight, broken it down here on the channel months ago. You know, I talked about that thing. And for those interested in that breakdown, for those interested in that video, I'll leave the link to it in the description box. But better still, if Sean wants the fight, that's what he's got to do. And it really is that simple.
It ain't complex.
Why does it seem like Errol Spence Jr.'s supporters have all this energy for Sean Porter to push for a Terrence Crawford fight, you know, because he's in a pole position to do so, yet they didn't exhibit this energy when Danny Garcia was in a pole position to do so? Maybe it's because they're holding out hope that Sean Porter can beat Terrence Crawford?
Yeah, right.
Well, maybe it's because they figure Sean Porter made Errol Spence Jr. look very human, and against Terrence Crawford, perhaps he could do a little better. I'm willing to bet generously that Terrence Crawford can not only beat Sean Porter, but he can stop him. He could actually be the first to do it. I reiterate, for those interested in the why, for those interested in my reasoning for that contention, I'll leave the link to it in the description box. I'm not averse to that fight. I never have been. I think that it is intriguing. I think that it is an opportunity for Terrence Crawford to show his levels against a PBC welterweight.
I just don't think it's necessary.
I don't view it as a requisite. I don't see it as being all important to building an Errol Spence Jr. fight, because Terrence Crawford is an unbeaten three-division champion. Sean Porter is not. Terrence Crawford doesn't have anything to prove to either Sean Porter or Errol Spence Jr. At this point, the logical course of action is to simply make the fight. But if by some chance Sean really wants the fight and he pushes for it and the WBO enforces the mandatory, hey, I'd purchase it on a pay-per-view. Why not? For the exact same reasons I've been tuning into all of Terrence Crawford's other fights, because these are fights that are happening in the mean and between time while Errol Spence Jr. tries to find his balls. Do I think that Terrence Crawford's critics would give him credit for beating Sean Porter or even stopping Sean Porter? No, I don't. Because they're not proposing that he fight Sean Porter so they can give him credit. They're only proposing he fight Sean as a means to buy Errol more time. That's all that is. That's a deflection tactic. Terrence Crawford gets a lot of criticism for what names aren't on his resume, names like Danny Garcia. But it was Danny Garcia who in January of this year was ranked as the WBO's number one contender. And he's the one who chose to go the other way. He's the one who decided to, later on that month, take on Ivan Redkack instead of challenging Terrence Crawford for the WBO title. And we know that the Crawford people wanted to fight because before that, months before that, a full year before that, they offered Danny Garcia the fight. They offered him a $1 million guarantee, several millions, and a pay-per-view upside to challenge Terrence Crawford. And then, like now, Danny walked away. Somehow that's Crawford's fault. In a nutshell, the situation at 147 pounds really hasn't changed. It hasn't actually gotten any better. It's more of the same in the welterweight division. And finally, on to lightweight news. You know, this weekend, we're in for a real treat. On the undercard of Stevenson versus Clary, we're going to get to see Puerto Rico's own Felix Verdejo versus Masayoshi Nakatani. This is the Masayoshi Nakatani that managed to give Teofimo Lopez a tougher time than Richard Comey and a tougher time than Vasyl Lomachenko. This is a very intriguing matchup as far as I'm concerned, because when it comes to Puerto Rico's own Felix Verdejo, you'll excuse me for saying so, but it seems like he's just living a double life, living independently of the rest of the lightweight division. You'd never think that this is a guy who's in the same weight class as a Ryan Garcia, a Devin Haney, a Teofimo Lopez, or a Vasyl Lomachenko. It seems like, you know, Felix, he's just in his own lane, and he's been in that lane for quite some time, and it's about time that things got interesting. I like the Masayoshi Nakatani fight.
Yeah!
The way boxing math works, if Felix Verdejo goes in there, and he just completely blows Masayoshi Nakatani out of the water, that doesn't necessarily mean that he would do that to Teofimo Lopez. That's a triangle theory. And in boxing, don't Those don't hold no water. Those don't work. Styles ultimately make fights. But if Felix is to go in there and he does blow Masayoshi Nakatani out of the water, what that does communicate is that Felix is on the level. It doesn't necessarily mean he beat Teofimo, but it does mean that he is competing at or around the same level as Teofimo because he can beat a common opponent with Teofimo. That is what that would mean. You know, I'm not your short-sighted, overly critical boxing fan. It takes a while for me to get a Charlie horse when it comes to a particular guy in my leg. And, you know, Felix, he's older than Ryan Garcia. He's older than Teofimo Lopez. He's older than Devin Haney. But this is his first real step up in competition. You'll excuse me for saying so, but yeah, it is. And he's older than those guys. I don't know if you're aware of this, but Felix Verdejo is almost 30 years old. That's right, the guy's 27 years old. And he hasn't bumped into an Anthony Crolla so much as an Anthony Crolla over Jorge Linares. Yeah, you know, I'm not saying that all these guys got to develop on the same schedule, that they're all operating at the same skill level. Sometimes some guys do need a little bit more bring along. It's just that for a guy that's almost 30, who's got more professional fights than a Teofimo Lopez, than a Ryan Garcia, so on and so forth. These young guys that are making more news than Felix is, you know? In Felix's situation, yeah, I need to see something, okay? You know?
Right.
I need to see something. I don't think I'm being short-sighted or overly critical. I'm just saying that it is about time that things got a little bit more interesting for Felix, because Felix is almost 30 years old. He's 27, and he's got almost 30 professional fights. He's 27-1. You don't see any Von Mendy on his resume. An Anthony Crolla, Jorge Linares, a Luke Campbell, an Emmanuel Togo, Jose Pedraza, a Richard Comey. I mean, it does beg the question that, you know, hey Felix, who have you been fighting for 27, 28 fights? You know, what the hell's going on here? He's on a 4-fight winning streak. I think this is a landmark fight for Felix. I think this is an important fight. I think a lot of people are going to be paying close attention to how Felix looks against Masayoshi as opposed to how Teofimo looked against Masayoshi. Teofimo did look noticeably human in that situation, as Masayoshi is an uncommonly statuesque lightweight. I mean, this is a big kid. I don't know how the hell he's getting down to 135 pounds. He's almost 6 feet tall.
Guy's goddamn coat rack.
Felix is on the beefier end of the spectrum as far as lightweights go. He's nowhere near as statuesque as Masayoshi, but, you know, Felix's build, his frame, this is a kid who could easily integrate himself into the 140-pound division, as he is on the heavier end of the spectrum in the lightweight division. This is actually a more intriguing matchup for this weekend's card than the main event.
And I'm looking forward to it.